So, good afternoon. Thank you all for coming back. I think that's a win for me to start with, actually. So what I'd like to do in this session, first and foremost, is actually make a promise to you. Okay? And it goes along this line. Okay, I want to make a promise to you that by the end of this session, I would have successfully convinced you as to how really cool and funky open source intelligence is, that you really would want to have it. You absolutely, without a doubt, would want to have it in your cybersecurity operations, okay? So now I made that promise. I hope I can live up to it. Secondly, most of this conversation here is going to be more about demonstrating some of the tools that are available out there. I truly do believe that seeing is believing in that respect. So with that in mind, I've got about 30 minutes, so I better scoot along here, okay? So to start with, I truly believe that we live in what has got to be one of the most volatile and technology-connected societies ever, period. In fact, technology is all around us. We're pretty much immersed in it. In fact, I would go so far as to say that in this day and age, we're pretty much technology-dependent. And the reality is a lot of that's been due to the phenomenon of digital transformation here. However, in spite of that wonderful growth that we're getting in terms of that business landscape, we also are quite cognizant of the fact that the threat landscape is also equally growing. And looking at some quick stats out here, that's a graph from CVE, the Common Vulnerability Exploits Database, and we can see that the trend is up in that respect. And in fact, 2013, there was over something like 16,400 new vulnerabilities that were disclosed. Now, when you break that down, that's roughly about 45 new vulnerabilities every day. So it's pretty compelling there, okay? Moving on. According to our friends at GDataSoft, when we look at malware, there's an upward trend over the years as well. And if you look at 2017 over there, okay, we've got somewhere around 8.4 million new malware specimens that were reported in that year. Now, this one's really interesting. When you break that down, that's something like 959 new malware specimens per hour. Okay, that's not a day, a week, a month. That's every hour. Now, I acknowledge the trend looks like it's dipping off a little bit there. I have it on good authority from them that what they're really seeing now is that the attacks are more targeted there, as less of a scattergun approach. Okay. Now, ransomware continues to grow, and what I'm talking about here is not just generic ransomware. What we're seeing is authors are more focused now on the mobile platform as opposed to the traditional PC. Okay. And a lot of the efforts are now going into improving their obfuscation techniques, which then makes it even more harder for cybersecurity folks to actually manage and eliminate this threat, okay? And lastly, what conversation would be complete without cloud, right? So cloud is actually going to create a lot of challenges for us going forward in the future. We have things like the challenge from jurisdictional and legislation, okay? How about the challenge from actually not even knowing where your data actually is residing at any point in time, okay? And then we have the risks that comes from increased vulnerabilities through shared infrastructure, all right? Shadow IT and shadow data. And how about this one, okay? The potential risks from privilege abuse by the cloud provider. Right? So we certainly have a lot of headwinds coming our way in that respect. Right? So it makes sense that from our perspective that we turn to a look at any alternative that helps us in the quest to keep our organizations, our business, you know, safe. And in this particular conversation, we want to look at open source intelligence, and I truly believe that it helps in terms of scaling cybersecurity and hopefully avoiding some of these, you know, nasty, very public type exposures and breaches. So what is open source intelligence? Yeah. Well, in 2011, a document was issued by the Director of National Intelligence and the DoD, which defines open source intelligence as what you can read up there. Okay. Now, the definition is slowly starting to evolve as the landscape continues to change, but it's pretty much true in that respect. I would ask if you could just, that last bit there, File that away for future reference, okay? That purpose, okay? Now, the open and open source intelligence refers to the fact that these are overt and public available sources, you know, quite sort of different or opposed to covert or clandestine sources, okay? And the origins, that is, the utilization of open source intelligence, actually dates back to the Second World War, when the US government recognized the value in open sources, in open intelligence media sources that were out there at the time. And back then, the focus was more about understanding, translating, and analyzing those media, radio broadcasts, as well as the press clippings and things like that. Okay? Now, the key behind open source intelligence, or the key term, if you want, is information here. It needs to be publicly available, it needs to be free, but most importantly, that information needs to be legal. Okay? And open source intelligence, properly implemented, really can make a difference. It can actually speed up and allow us to focus our cybersecurity operations and investigations. Okay? So, in particular, when we're talking about the internet, it's extremely vast. We have enormous amounts of information out there. So, all that information actually comes in a whole range of different formats. Okay. So, I've got a bit of a bird's eye view here in respect to some of these data categories out there. You know, we've got things by way of social media platforms up there. Wealth of information that's out there. If you don't believe me, tell it to the victims of Facebook and Cambridge Analytica. Okay. At the other end of the spectrum, websites hold a lot of information on individuals or organizations as well. We have news articles, you know, audio, video type things, blogs, posts, whole range of different data formats and data categories, including things like data repositories like GitHub. If any of you remember the old Uber hack that was in the last few years? That actually originated through GitHub at the time. Okay. So there's a wealth of information in all these different types of repositories out there. So that with all that information out there, what we really need is a methodical approach in terms of how we actually organize our process to sift through all that information in terms of applying an open source intelligence technique. And these, what I got up there, are the basic rudimentary process in terms of what you need to look at. Right. So starting at the top, you're talking about the direction and planning. Now remember that last bit of the definition, you've got to have a purpose, a mission for what you're trying to solve here. Right. In this phase, what you're really focusing on is identifying the sources that are relevant for you and your organization. Right. For example, if you're a Windows workshop in terms of your business, then there's no point identifying a really awesome Linux information repository. There's no relevance there. So identifying the sources. Okay. Two is the collection phase. Now, having identified your sources, it's all about how you actually extract the information for your usage. Now, a word of caution here. Depending on the nature of that source, you may have to seriously consider how you go about collecting it. For example, and this comes from personal experience, when you're actually extracting information from a source that is also associated with a particular case that's under investigation, you may need to use techniques that obfuscate your identity because you don't want to actually give that away to the source that's being investigated, if you get what I mean. Okay? Thirdly, having identified and extracted, you need to process this. Now, this is where you actually start to sieve through the information and get relevant sort of artifacts of interest bubbling up. Okay. Fourth, now that you've got those pieces of information all together, the analysis is about stitching it all together. You want to build that final picture. Again, remember the definition. Okay? You want to pull that picture to answer that problem, that question that was the purpose of this exercise. And finally, having done all that analysis, you need to format, report that, and communicate that upwards. And then the whole sequence starts again for your next mission. Okay. So I mentioned earlier how vast the internet is. Okay? And that volume of data information continues to grow infinitely more every day. So this is where things like the tools come into play. And they can make a big difference in terms of how you actually extract that information. Right tools, properly implemented, can give you the information you need within seconds or minutes at most. Now, I've got a few of them up there in terms of some of the more well-known ones. Shodan, I'm sure a few of you may have heard of Shodan. Yes, got some nods, excellent. So it's a basically it's a network security monitor and search engine, pretty much focused on the deep web and IoT in particular, okay? Commonly known as a search engine for hackers, if you want, okay? You see, what Shodan does, it allows you to actually identify and then explore virtually any device that's connected to the network, okay? But even more so, it allows you to scan the internet for pretty much anything, and I mean really anything. You know, everyone thinks about the traditional things like your PCs, your servers, and routers. No, I'm talking about virtually anything in the context of home heating systems, traffic lights and traffic management systems, and even nuclear power plants, okay? It's actually quite a free and powerful open source tool. URL scan, cool and funky tool. Basically what it does is it allows you to understand what a website is doing. Now it does that by scanning the website and then identifying and analyzing all the requests that it makes out, as well as the domain requests as well. Basically it allows you to do full recon on your specific target. Okay? And lastly, the harvester there. Another really cool tool in terms of getting information around emails and domains, things like open ports, employee names, numbers. It's bundled into Kali. They've got any pen testers out there? No? Okay, if you don't, yeah? Okay, so you get what I mean. They've got Kali. Kali's a great platform. All pen testers and hackers, unfortunately, really like it. Okay, so it's bundled into that toolkit already in that respect. It really allows you to get a really good view about what the attackers can see with regards to your organization's footprint out there. And there's a whole bunch of them, all right? I've barely scratched the surface in terms of what's out there. Okay. Ah, so getting into the magic now, okay? So we're going to go look at some of these tools and operations here, because I've got one or two really good stories here, okay? This is an email that I actually received a couple of months ago. And as I was roped into this opportunity, as I really wanted this opportunity, did I get that right? Okay. I thought this would be a really good, simple exercise to demonstrate some of the tools that are out there. So I got that email. If you take who the sender was, I plugged it into a website. There's a basic sort of a tool out there, Stop Forum Spam. After plugging it in, it gave me a list of IPs there, came up in red, right? All the same IPs. So the next step, I thought, okay, all right. So I got an indication that there's something not quite right with this particular email, beyond obviously knowing it looked a little bit suspicious to start with. Take that IP address, and I plugged it back in and did a second search, and lo and behold, there's a massive list of other emails and scams associated with that particular IP address. So I'm starting to think, yeah, this is really not particularly good, okay? So next, I decide, all right, I'm going to take the domain name at the end, the bk.ru, and I plug it into whois. It returns you a bunch of information you have up there. But of particular note, I now know that it is actually a live registered domain address, registered in Russia. Okay, another indicator. It starts to add up, if you want. Finally, URL void. It's a reputation IP website tool, okay? Same thing, so I plugged that domain in there. You can't quite see it, but that little bit up there, that returns a reputation status, and it's been blacklisted. So after a bit of simple sort of checks like that, I can safely say that that domain is predominantly used to launch phishing campaigns and quite possibly also to serve up malware. Okay. It's dodgy. I mentioned Shodan earlier, that really cool and funky search engine of the internet out there. So what I decided to do here for a simple demonstration, when Bangkok in Thailand, so I did a simple search, looking for all default passwords that were accessible within Thailand. It's quite an interesting return here. Can't quite see it, but yeah, default password, country, Thailand, bang. And what did we find? 3,225 devices currently connected to the internet in Thailand, out of the box with just default passwords. And unfortunately, you can't see it, but you got one there, which is admin, password is 1234. Down the bottom here is a government-related organization in Thailand. I can tell they use Cisco, because it's got Cisco up there. Login, Cisco. Password, Cisco. No, I did not push in any further and try any of those, okay? There's a line you've got to cross, okay? So anyway, you get the idea. It's a simple search there. So I picked one, this one here. It's a internet communications and broadband company in Thailand. Just to show you what else you can get out of that. Okay? So you push in there. There's some additional information on that entity there, including an ASN number. If you know anything about an ASN number, every network on the internet has a unique ID, and that's it. Right? Every network has an ASN number. Your organization's network will have an ASN number, okay? Every single one. So that's a bit of useful information to uniquely identify a network. Additionally, all these, they're all open ports. Now, that's just a top snap of that whole page that streams down, but you get the picture, all right? You can go and have a look at it, play with it. Infinitely powerful tool. Okay. URL scan. Okay. So I admit I'm still a bit of a security geek. This is where the other bit comes out. Spent 32-odd years in government, federal government there, doing all these different things. So now you know something a little bit more about me, because I got no choice, I'm going to reveal that very shortly. So as I say, I used to work for everybody's favorite federal government agency, the tax office. Yes, everyone nod, awesome agency, right? No. Anyway, so on this instance, I'm still quite connected with a lot of my colleagues there. So I thought I'll do a simple URL scan on ATO, Australian Tax Office, which I did. And that's what it returned. So there's what the front screen looks like of the website. Okay, no worries. Had a couple of interesting bits of information up there that correlated, makes sense. Then as I started sifting through the data, I thought, okay, what can I tell? Anyone know who Akamai is? Okay, good, yeah. So now I know the ATO utilizes DDoS protection provided by Akamai. But not only do I know that, I also know now the service is routed through the EU. Okay, all additional bits of information if you're doing recon, right? Main domain's fine. Everything else kind of looked okay, but then I go, okay. Someone else is obviously quite interested in that particular federal government entity, so it's been scanned 26 times. But lastly, for me, that one. There are multiple structurally similar pages, IPs, domains, and ASNs. Remember what I said earlier? ASNs is a singular, unique ID for a network. Why am I going to have multiple for a federal government agency like tax office? So my spider senses started tingling, okay? So I pushed in on that. And this is what it returned, okay? Says, okay, that first one in particular doesn't have a region. Although if you look at the other ones, South Africa, Australian tax office, or something, yeah, something's not right here, okay? So for the purpose of demonstrations, I picked the top one and I pushed in further on that one. And here's where it really sort of started to unfold for me that this is seriously something's wrong here. And this was done purely for this delivery and this exercise, okay? But first and foremost, URL has absolutely nothing to do with the Australian Taxation Office. Big indicator there to start with, right? Secondly, in the Ascension Islands? Now, if you do your Google search or whatever it is, the Ascension Islands is a little cluster of islands that sits in the middle of the South Atlantic. It's bordered on one side by South America and the other side's Africa. Last time I went to work at the ATO, it was still in Australia, in Canberra, okay? So something was really seriously not right here. And to add to boot, safe browsing gave us a malicious rating as well. For me, that's the front page. Remember, it always shows you the web page. I know for certain that the Australian Tax Office does not actually receive payment by credit card. Never have, never will. So at this point, this is dodgy as hell. So I called up colleagues who I'm still connected with there. In fact, my team, I looked after the incident response team at the tax office, so I know them quite well. I said, hey guys, I think I got a dodgy one for you. Passed it on to them. Within 1 hour, they got back to me and said, yep, that's 100%. It's scamming people to their credit cards, money, all that sort of stuff. They've issued a takedown on it. So in the course of doing this, not only did I demonstrate the tool, found something that was actually legitimately dodgy. Last one for you. As I mentioned, I worked for a federal entity. One of the things we used to run quite regularly, every 2 years, authorised by the tax commissioner, we undertook a full red team. So it's people, process, logical, physical access. Anything was game. This is just an example. At the start of one of our campaigns, we crafted an email. In doing this, what we did was we knew there was a big SAP convention that was coming up in 2 months. So we went online, did some basic searches, you know, open source intelligence, right? We actually got hold of one of the emails that they use for invitation. So we structured and crafted it in the same way. All that is pretty much legit. And then we crafted our own bit of malware, which was attached up there, okay? So it's a standard sort of dropper. You know, click open, installs, calls back to our server. We drop the payload in, we own the box. We can go in and out, watch anything. We sent this to the SAP engineers in the Australian Tax Office. Now, how do we find out all that? LinkedIn, Government Services Directory. It's all public available information, all right, if you know where to look. So anyway, send that in. 20 minutes is all it took. First person to click that, boom, we owned a box. Within an hour, we had six. Owned them, okay? Needless to say, Commissioner was kind of happy, but not happy at the same time, if you know what I mean. Anyway, simple example in terms of how you utilize open source intelligence, okay? So to round things out, the latest Verizon data breach report came out a couple of months ago. There's an excerpt in that towards the back. One of the first times now that the United States Secret Service is actually providing a significant report and update as an adjunct to it. And what was interesting in there, from Michael, what the Secret Service does is when they catch any of these bad cyber criminals, they conduct these briefing sessions with them. And the whole purpose is to get first-hand knowledge from these hackers and what have you in the community as to their methods and techniques. How do they identify their targets for intrusion and exploitation? Okay, and it just so happened that earlier this year they'd finish a bunch of briefings. So they put all that information in this report. It's kind of cool, all right? So don't expect you to read all that, but the point being, okay, cyber criminals do their research. Almost always during these interviews, the hackers referred to gathering valuable intelligence from the same security blogs, online security publications, vulnerability reports, networks. You get the picture, right? And this bit here. Once a target is selected, the hacker conducts thorough research into the victim organization and networks, often using free and commercially available internet scanning tools that reveal extreme. So my point is, the bad guys are doing it. Why aren't we doing it? You know, these are free, open resources, and they're powerful. They actually do work. We've seen that now. So one last thing. It was interesting. You may be familiar with the attack kill chain. So this is what the bad guys step through in terms of how they launch their attacks, okay? I know recon, okay? On the other hand, I know there was a few pen testers in there, okay? So the good guys, we do pen testing, red teaming, all that sort of stuff. That's our method. Oh, look at that, recon. It's the same phases, same tools. Come on. We should be using these types of capabilities. So, to summarize, if you look at the rationale behind all these motivations, it's always going to be money or the data. If it's not money directly, it's the data because they can monetize it for money. If someone goes after the data and they don't monetize it, it's highly likely a nation state because they're going to use it for some other means, you know, coerce someone, blackmail them, whatever the case may be. All right. Exercise care. That's one of the things that we've been educating people. Be careful how much you share. I think we live in this technology connected society, and we love to post things everywhere. All right. Preferably none of your work stuff you should be posting, okay? So we need to think more consciously how much and how we share. Awareness, humans the weakest link. Yeah, that campaign that we launched in terms of that spearfish, it's about educating the individuals how to be able to identify what may be a susceptible email, okay? And we really do have poor rates of actually recovery or discovery in terms of getting that visibility into our networks, understanding behaviors, be able to, you know, compress the time frame from discovery to remediation, hopefully eliminate the breach, right? And I keep saying it, the bad guys, your adversaries are using it. You know, get out there, start looking at some of this stuff. So much of it is free, let alone what there may be a small fee for any of the really, really funky platforms out there. Okay. So I hope I've kept my promise. If I didn't, please don't tell me, I don't want to know. Okay. But I'm a true believer in it. We used it when I was in FedGov. It's very effective. I really do hope that you are convinced enough to at least look into it in terms of the opportunities it presents in the future. Thank you very much for listening.